what we'll be creating in this tutorial, controlling the famous Subway Surfer game via your body gestures. And the best part is, we'll not be using any depth camera. Your normal webcam will do fine for this tutorial. And this is called a human-computer interaction-based application, or an HCI application. And this is not the first time I'm creating something like this. I've created two other applications. In one application, I controlled a game via my hand gestures and a video player. And in another one, I controlled the famous Google Dino game via my facial gestures. Both of these two applications were published in LearnOpenCV.com. Before I start with the code, I actually have a short personal story which motivated me to create this application. You can skip this part if you want. So here's the thing. When I was growing up, specifically in my early teenage years, I wasn't into computers or any sort of technology for that matter. I spent most of my time, playing games or doing activities outdoors. And because of those outdoor activities, I didn't need to worry about what I eat or take out time to exercise. But as I grew older and I got into programming, and specifically when I started VDI, I had to spend most of my time sitting in front of a PC. So I'll be spending hours and hours in front of a PC every day. And this caused a bit of problems for me. So the thing was, and I started to notice that I was gaining a bit of weight, and the obvious solution for me was to go join a gym. But I did that, and then I quit after a month. It was really difficult to manage, your computer science. And then again, a year later, I joined again, and then quit it again after 2 months. And before calling it quits completely, I tried yet again for the third time, 8 months back. And I'm happy to say that I'm still at it. So this 8 months helped me to, lose a couple of things. And it was really, really beneficial in a lot of ways. I haven't still yet reached my personal targets, but I might. And so here's the issue. I know a lot of programmers and developers, just like you, find it really difficult to take out time to go out to the gym or exercise. So why not combine computer science with working out? Create something that hit two birds at once. So this is what led me to create this application. And this is just one application. You can control different sort of games with different sort of gestures and utilizing different body movements. And it will be really helpful not only in flourishing your vision skills, but also helping you exercise and work out at the same time. And I'm not a fitness guru or something like that, but I can confidently say that exercising and working out not only helps you lose weight, but it has a lot of other benefits. Like, it gives you mental clarity and actually proves your worth. And it has a lot of health benefits too. And if you're still single like me, it will help you get a partner. Anyways, let's start with the code. So this is the notebook that we'll be using today. It's neatly structured and outlines all of the steps that are required to create this full application. I'll initially break it down in bit-by-bit steps, and I'll explain each of the steps. Then in the final step, I'll combine all of the things and create the final application. So this is how this will work. So right now, what we want is create an application that controls this game. And the four controls that we need to worry about are these four. So we need to have a system that can make the character in here jump, crouch, and move to the left or move to the right. So the story behind this game is that this guy has to run from the policeman, and he has to continuously keep running and dodging obstacles in front. And he has these four controls which helps him evade capture and obstacles. So this is how we play the game. So we have these six steps. So initially we learn to perform pose detection, then we'll learn a starting mechanism, how to start the game. And then we'll see how we can have a left-right movement or horizontal movement mechanism. And then we'll see how to make the character jump, crouch, or stand still. So that's what vertical movements will control. And the fifth step, we'll see how to combine all of this with PyAdobe, which lets you control your keyboard inputs. And then in the final step, we'll combine all of this together. So to get started, what we need to do is import these libraries. We'll be working primarily with PyAdobe, OpenCV, and MediaFire. So these are the three main libraries. The other three one will probably be installed in your system. Anyways, let's start with the code by running this cell. Now all the libraries are imported. Now, what I will do is initialize the post-detection model. So I've already covered in detail how the post-detection works in my previous, in the last week tutorials. So make sure to go over that. But for the sake of this tutorial, I'll briefly cover how post-detection is working. So we're initializing the post-detection class, then we're setting up the post-detection function. And I'm doing this two times, one for the images and the other for the videos. So what the difference between those two initializations is that in image mode, I'm setting the static image mode to true, and then I'm setting the static image mode to false. So this is the function which I'll be calling when I'm working with videos. And this is a function I'll be calling when I'm working with images. So, and there's some intuition behind that, which I covered in the previous tutorial. Anyways, then I'm initializing the drawing class, which will help me to draw the whole pose skeleton on the person. All right, let me run this. Now the pose detection is initialized. Now we'll perform the pose detection. So when we do pose detection, we'll have this sort of a skeleton, which will give us 33 landmark key body joints on the body. And using those key landmark points, we can do anything. We can do all sort of analysis and stuff like that. And as you can see, the whole notebook is highly documented. So you can go over these descriptions when you download the notebook. And there's also an associated blog post for this video. So you'll get the most out of this lesson by going over the video, by going over the blog post, and by going over this notebook. All right. And so this is the skeleton that we'll be detecting. And all we need to do is create this function, which will perform the full pose detection and do the pre and post processing and display all the images. So what it's doing is that it's taking an image and then converting the image to RGB. Because in OpenCV, when you read an image, you read the image in BGR and you need to convert it into RGB to pass it into this pose detection first function. And when you call pose.process on the image, the whole pose detection will be done on this singular line. And then you will get the results in the form of results object. And then inside this object, you will check if the pose was detected. And if it was, then what we will do is draw out the whole landmark points. This will draw out the whole skeleton of the pose. And if display is set to true, you will display out the results on top of an image. And you will also display the original image besides that. And if display is set to false, which will be false when we are working with videos, you will just return the output annotated image along with the actual results. So again, I've covered all of this in detail in the previous tutorial. So now I will read a sample image and run the pose detection on top of it. So I'm reading an image here, and then I'm calling the detect pose function on this image. And then I'm setting the draw equals to true, which will make sure the pose skeleton is drawn, and display equals to true, which will display the results in that project. So this is how this will work. So this was the original image, and this is the pose skeleton on top of this image. So this is how the pose detection will work. Now that we have figured out and covered how pose detection will work, let's get into the control mechanisms. The first mechanism that we need to worry about is how the game will start. So this is the starting mechanism, and my condition for that to happen is that when the person combines both of his left and right hand together, only then the game or the application should start. So this is the condition which will enable the application to start. And this is an optional step, but it helps in a lot of cases. So we'll create the final application. You will see that there are a couple of thresholds that you need to set it manually. But you can avoid doing that if you have this sort of a mechanism. And this game starting mechanism has a lot of useful cases. Not only it will help us start the game, it will help us pause the game when we want to take a break or go over to the PC and configure some options. And it will also help us later pick out a shoulder threshold value, which I'll explain later why that is important. But right now, all we need to do is understand how will this code work. So I have a function that is labeled as check hands joined, and it will take an image. It will take the results object. This will contain the pose landmarks. All right. So now what we will do is I will get the left wrist landmark points and the right wrist landmark point. So this is the left wrist landmark point. This is this point, and this is the right wrist landmark point. And to extract these individual points, I'm gonna use this particular syntax. Results.post landmarks. Landmark and dpost.landmark.leftlist. This is the syntax to extract the individual left pips x coordinate. And then this is for the y coordinate. And remember to multiply this with the width and the height, because initially what you will get is xy coordinates, you normalize to the range 0 to 1, and you need to multiply with the width and the height to get the actual coordinates. So we're doing this for the left wrist landmark, and we're doing this for the right wrist landmark. Now I have x and y coordinates for this point and x, y, y coordinates for this point. All I need to do is figure out how close these two points are. And to do that, I'll just calculate an equidistant distance between those two points. So it's a really popular distance metric, which will give you distance between two xy points. So this is what I'm calling here. And if the distance between those two points is less than some threshold, which I'm defining it as 130, you can decrease or increase this depending upon your particular use, but 130 will work fine. So if that is the case, if the distance is really small, I need to, you know, like set the hand status to hands are joined. And then if that is not the case, if the hands are far off, then I need to set the hand status to hands are not joined. And then what I'm doing is just drawing out and putting up the text if the hands are joined or not. And then I'm displaying the image if working with images. And if I'm working with videos, I'm just going to return the output. So this is how this whole simple function is structured. So let me run this. And then once the function is ready, I'm going to test it out in a video. So this is what is going to, this is the whole code for that. I'm just setting up the camera parameters and initializing the webcam I want to use, setting up the name window, which will help me to resize the window. I'm checking if the camera is open or not. Then I'm reading the camera frame by frame. I'm checking to make sure if the frame was read correctly. I'm flipping it laterally so that I see a mirror image. And then I'm extracting the width and height. And then what I'm doing is the individual poses. So what I'm going to get is the results. This is the pose landmarks. And then I'm checking to make sure if the pose were detected or not. So you need to first check before calling this function. Otherwise, this function will give you an error because you won't have any results object for that particular iteration of the loop. So I'm checking to make sure if the pose was detected. And if it is, I'm going to, you know, like, call the check hands joined function, which I just explained, and grab the annotated frame and then display the results. And if the user presses the escape button on the keyboard, I'm gonna break out of the loop, I'm gonna release the camera, and I'm gonna destroy all the loops. By the way, all of this code will be repeated multiple times in this whole tutorial, and every time I'll be checking a different function. So I'm just explaining this once, and the next time I'm gonna use a video, I'm not gonna explain this whole script because it's going to be the same. Anyways, let's test it out.
So the pose detection is running and these are my hands. When I bring them closer to the camera, you will see at the top here, the distance will decrease. And if I set them apart, the distance will increase, right? So decrease and increase. And then when I finally join them, you will see the hands are joined, indicated there. So this is how this whole thing is going to work.
So I press the escape button and it exited out. Let's move on to the next control mechanism, which is the horizontal control mechanism. And this is how this will work. So, okay, let me just zoom out a bit. Okay. So as you can see here, what we're going to do is instead this time extracting the wrist points, I'm going to extract the shoulder point from the left side and then the shoulder point from the right side. And then I'm going to see if the center of the image, this central line, is between those two parts. If it is, then the horizontal position is set as center. And if both of these left and right points are on the right side of the image, like this, then the person is standing to the right side. So the horizontal position should be set to right. And then if both of these points are on the left of the image, like here, then the horizontal position will be set as left. So this is all I'm doing. So to do that, what I'm going to do, this function is going to be pretty similar to the above one. So what I'm going to do is, initially set the horizontal position to null. And all the stuff I'm doing here is in this function called check left right. So in this function, I'm setting initially the horizontal position to none, and then I'm extracting the left x and the right x. So what I'm doing is, instead of grabbing the full xy, I'm just concerned with the x coordinate, because the y coordinate would be, you know, like useful in this scenario. I'm just concerned with how the shoulder is relative to the x coordinate. So I'm only grabbing the left x of the left shoulder and the right x of the, you know, like right shoulder, x coordinate. And then I'm checking if both of these points are to the left side of the head. And if that is the case, then horizontal position should be set as left. And if both of these points are on the right side of the image, then horizontal position should be set as right. And if one point is to the left and the other point is to the right, then the horizontal position should be centered. And similarly, if the draw variable is true, I'm drawing out the results on the image. And if display set to true, I'm displaying it. This is the scenario when I'm working with images. And if I'm working with videos, I'm just returning the results. So let's run this. Now the function is initialized, time to test out. Similarly, it's the same code which I just checked for the hand joint function. Right now, I'm just doing it for the left joint function. So I'm going to run this. So as you can see, right now, the status is centered. So what you're going to see is centered written on the bottom of the screen. But if I move to the left, you'll see that it's written left. And if I move to the right, you're going to see the right. So right, left, and then center. So this is how this is going to work. Now let's create a function that will control the vertical movement. So we need to make the character jump, crouch, or stay still. So for that, we'll be creating this function check jump crouch. And this function will work similarly to the above one. So, but there are a few differences here. So right, previously we were working with the horizontal axis, right now we work with the vertical axis. So to check the horizontal vertical movement of the body. So for that, what we'll do is get this midpoint. This midpoint lies between the shoulders. So what I'm going to do is grab the X shoulder point, the Y of the left shoulder and the right shoulder, and get the midpoint in between here, which will be somewhat here. And then I'll have this threshold line. This white line is the threshold line. And with this threshold line, I'll get two other thresholds. So this will be the lower bound and this will be the upper bound. And then I'll have some if-else conditions which will check if this midpoint is below the lower bound. If it is, then the vertical position will be set as crouching. And if it is in between those lower and upper bounds, then the vertical position will be set as standing. If it is above the upper bound, then the vertical position will be set as jumping. So one thing that might come to your mind is, why are we having three separate lines? Why not just have one singular threshold? And if the midpoint is below that, we'll set it to crouching. If the midpoint is on top of that, we'll set it to standing. And if the midpoint is above that, we'll set it to jumping. And this can theoretically work fine, but here's the issue. If you set a singular point, then only the whole system will fluctuate a lot, and it will be really difficult to make the character stand, because only when you have that midpoint on exactly that particular line, it will be considered as standing. So this is why we have some padding values, some threshold pads. So this will help us to control on the whole thing. So what we're going to do is pick out a certain threshold. So the Y value is 0 at the top and it increases and is max at the bottom. So for example, if I pick out a threshold as 70, so if I pick out a threshold of 70, this means the Y axis value on 70 is the threshold line, and I'll have some padding then. So if I add a padding of 30, so what this means is that threshold plus 30 is the upper bound and threshold minus 30 is the lower bound. So if the object or the midpoint is below, if the y-axis value of this midpoint is below that 40 value, then it will be considered as jumping. And if it is above the 100 value, it will be considered as crouching. And if it is in between 40 and 100, it will be considered as standing. So this is how this whole function will work. And this is the full explanation which I just gave in code. So I'm just extracting the left y-coordinate of the the shoulder and the right y coordinate of the shoulder, and then I'm calculating the midpoint by dividing it by 2 and adding these two up. And then what I'm going to do is get the lower and upper bound by adding and subtracting some particular threshold values. So I'm setting the padding value as 25. I'm hard coding this, but you can have this as a hyperparameter and put it here. So, but I'm just hard coding this right now. So 35 is the padding value. And the midway point is set to 250. So I'm going to add 250 at 35 to 250, and this will be the upper bound. And I'll subtract 35 from the 250, and this will be the lower bound. So now we're going to check if the y-axis value is less than the lower bound. So remember, the y-axis value is 0 at the top and it increases at the end. So this is why I'm checking to make sure if the mid y value is less than the lower bound, which means it's on the top here. So if that is the case, then I'm setting the postal variable as jumping. And if it is greater than the upper bound, then I'm setting is the poster variable as crouching. So this means the midway is further than the greater than the upper bound variable. So the poster will be crouching. And if it both of these are not the cases, then the poster will be set as standing. So I can also check if the value is in between those points, but I'm assuming that if both of these cases are not the scenario, then obviously the person would be standing. So that is why poster will be standing. And then similarly, it's the whole repetition of code. So I'm drawing out the results, I'm displaying the image, and I'm returning the results if I'm working with videos. So this is the whole function for that. And remember, I'm hard coding a couple of values. So these three thresholds, this midline and this padding values, are being hard coded right now. So you might need to change some of these to make it work in this demo. But later on in the final application, I'll show you an automated way so that you don't need to configure the midway value. Anyways, let's run this. So this is how this will work. Right now I'm standing here, and if I crouch down, I'm crouching. And if I do that, I'm jumping. So this is standing, and then this is jumping. All right, and this is crouching. So this is how this works. Now in step 5, we'll see how we can control the keyboard inputs with a library called PyOctogui. So what we need to do is pip install PyOctogui to have it in your system. And there's a nice demo which shows you how to control another game. So people have been controlling games and applications with PyOctogui. So it's a really interesting library. So it's pretty simple. So all you need to do is import PyOctogui. After you install it, then run PyOctogui.press keys, and any key that you pass in here, it will be pressed. So if I run this cell, the up key would be pressed. Similarly, if I run this cell, the down key button, the down arrow button will be pressed. And I can press multiple buttons at a time by doing something like this. So PyOctogui.press, and this will do what this will do is to press up button 4 times, and then it will press the down button in the 5th time. So and similarly, I can also do something like this. If I want to press a singular button multiple number of times, so keys down, I want to press the down button 4 times. So this is what this will do. And then I also have another function called PyOctogui.keyDown. And this, what will it do? It's not to press the button, but hold it down. And then it will release this button when I do this. PyOctogui.keyUp, key shift. So it will, what will it do? It will do when I run this cell is press down the shift button. And then it will release the shift button when I call this line. And between those lines, whatever button I press, the shift button will automatically be pressed down at that point in time. So when I press the enter 2 times, the shift button would have been pressed. So if I run this cell, what you will see is that whenever you want to execute a cell in the Jupyter Notebook, you hold down the shift button, press the enter. So when I run this cell, automatically the previous two cells below were run. So this is what PyOctogui does. All right. So another function that we have, things we can do is that you can down control, and then you can press any hot keys. So there's a whole plethora of functions and controls that you can do with PyOctogui directly. You can also control the mouse with it. So and you can also tell the mouse to go at a certain point in screen and then click the right or the left button or scroll down or scroll up, things like that. So PyOctogui is a pretty powerful library to control your keyboards and the mouse. And it also has a bunch of other utility functions. So make sure to go over the docs of part of it if you want to in like go over it in more detail. But this information will suffice to create this application. All right, step six, we'll create and build the final application. We'll use all of those functions which we have created above in the previous steps. And we'll put it all together to build up the final application. And so this is how this will work. It's pretty simple. We'll just doing a lot of things that we're going to do here is going to be pretty obvious. So we are going to initialize the camera, set up the window, and then I have this variable called game start. This will hold the information regarding if the game has started or not. And the game will only start, remember, when I combine both of my hands together. So this way, this variable will be true. And the other thing that we need to understand right now is that I have these two variables. So this is the X position index and this is the Y position index. And any point in the game, this position index or these variables will tell you where the person is. So if the person is standing to the left, the position index will be 0. And if the person is standing at the center, the position index will be 1, which is initially. And if the person is standing to the right, the position index will be to the right. So this variable will control where the person is any time in the game. And similarly, we have a Y position index, which controls where the person is relative to the Y axis. So if it is standing, the person is standing, this variable will be 1, which initially when the game starts, it is assumed the person is standing. So this variable will be incremented if the person is jumping, and it will be decremented when the person is crouching. So this will become 0 when the person is crouching. And the whole idea behind creating and storing these indexes and storing the information regarding to the person's position is that we don't end up pressing multiple presses of keyboard. So if you move to the left, we tell the part of you to keep pressing the left button. So this will cause a lot of problems if you're not handling. This will help us handle and smooth out the whole operations. So this is why we are storing these indexes. And below the code, you will see how we use those indexes to press the keyboard buttons. Anyways, so these are the two indexes. Right now, the midwire, see here, I'm not hard coding the midwire value. Previously, when I showed you how the vertical crouching and jumping mechanism work, I hard coded this value, but right now I'm not going to hard code this value. I'm going to, whenever I combine both of my hands, at that point in time, the automatically the midpoint will be extracted and that will be stored as the midwire value. So only combine those hands together when you're perfectly in your ideal position. You're standing in your ideal position when you want to play out the game. So this is what this variable is like. Okay. And what we're going to do now is start reading the camera frame by frame, and we're doing the bunch same thing. We're flipping the frame, reading frame by frame, and then we're detecting the poses. And if the pose is detected, then we're going to check if the game has started. Initially, when you run it for the first time, the game will not be started. So this whole addition will be skipped, but this will be run. So else. So when you run this cell, first time, this will be executed. So what we're going to do is right on the screen, join both hands to start the game. This will be written on top of the screen. And then what we'll do is call this check hands join function again and again until the person has combined those hands to join the game. And if it has, then we're going to set this game started variables equals to true. And then what I'm going to do is automatically at that point in time, extract the left Y X point and the right Y X point and calculate the mid X point automatically. And this is going to be the mid Y value. At that threshold. So this is going to be that threshold value. It is going to be automatically set when you combine the hands. The other thing that I'm doing here is a bit of error handling. So I'm not immediately setting the game started variable to true. What I'm doing is appending a counter variable. When this counter reaches a certain threshold value, which is right now I'm setting it as 20. When I join my hands, and for 20 straight iterations, my hands are joined, only then I'm going to set this game starting variables to true. And the reason behind that is to avoid starting the game due to false positives. So consider it not in the screen, and there's a false detection. And due to that false detection, the hands might be considered, you know, like they are close together, and the application might start due to that. So to avoid that particular scenario, which is a really niche scenario, won't happen much, but at times still handling. So this is what this is controlling. This is making sure that you're pressing your hands for 1 or 2 seconds. And if that happens, then only then we're going to start the game. All right. So this is what is happening here. And once the game starts, this is what is going to happen. What we're going to do is get the horizontal position by calling the check left, right method. And then we're going to check if the horizontal position is left, we're going to tell the participant to press the left button. So the person moves to the left. And similarly, if the horizontal position is to the right, so meaning the person is standing to the right or has moved to the right of the screen, then we'll tell the participant to press the right button so that the character in the game moves to the right. And I'm also checking a bunch of other things. So not only am I checking if the horizontal position is left, I'm also making sure if the X position index is not zero. So if it is zero, which means I'm already present at the end of the screen, I'm already present at the end. Remember, the X position index will be zero when you're to the left of the screen. So if it is zero, then we don't need to press the left button. So this is why I'm checking to make sure I'm not already standing to the left of the screen to avoid pressing the left button multiple times. So this is what this is being controlled here. Similarly, because of this, I also need to handle another scenario, which is that if I move from the right of the screen to the left, and this time if I do that, then my horizontal position will be centered, but I have moved to the left. And I can handle that scenario with these conditions. If horizontal position is center and I have moved from the right of the screen. And so in that scenario, you also have to press the left button. So there can be two possible conditions here. Let me just show you what I mean by this. So I might have moved to the left from the center like this. So in this scenario, you have to press the left button. And I also have to move to the left from the right of the screen. So I'm on the right and then I have to move to the left from there. Now, in both of these conditions, my horizontal position would either be left or center, depending upon from where I moved. All right. So this is what's happening here. And similarly, I'm doing the same thing. So I'm checking here if the person have moved to the right from the left of the screen or if it has moved to the right from the center of the screen. So both times I need to press the right button to make the character move to the right. And once it does that, I'm going to increment this X position index. And if I move to the left, I'm going to decrement this X position index. So at any point in the game, I know where the person's X position is. Another optional thing that I'm doing here is this. So I'm making part of the wheel library, press the space button on your keyboard when you join your hands together. So the first time, this will let you start the game. But after the game has started, the next time you combine your hands together, it's going to press the space button. And this is going to let you pause the game or restart the game, you know, like when your character dies or and things like that. So this is pretty useful. So control or pause the game. All right. So we have seen how we can control the horizontal movement with this. Now, in the same way, I'm going to control the vertical movement. So for that, I have the code here. So not this one, but like, I think, where is it? So yeah, this is it. So this is the code where I'm checking the jump crouch, calling the jump crouch function, and I'm extracting the poster. This is going to tell me if the person is jumping. If it is, then press the up button. And if the person is crouching, then press the down button. And if the person is standing, then set the position index as well. And if it is jumping, I'm going to increment the Y position index. And if it is crouching, then I'm going to decrement the Y position index. So this is a simple code. And this is all the code you need to control the vertical movement of that character. And finally, we have this code. This is just the FPS calculation. So we're calculating the frames per second and then displaying it on top of the screen. So you see how fast your whole processing pipeline is working. Finally, we are showing the results on the screen. And finally, if the person presses the escape button, I'm going to exit out of the application and I'm going to release the camera and destroy all the windows. So this is the full application. If you don't understand any of the steps, then go over the code. It's completely documented and commented. It will help you out a lot. All right. Now that we have seen the code, it's time for the best part. Let's run this cell and play this game. Now, before you run this cell, go to the top and click this tab. This will launch the service of an online game. And once you're ready, you can press the play button and then launch this application. Join both of your hands together to start the game. So now let's check it out. So the pose detection model is running right now. All I need to do is combine both of my hands and the application will start. So if I move to the left, it will be left. And if I move to the right, it will be right. Now if I jump here, it will be jumping. And if I crouch, it will be crouching. So this is how this works. Now let's play the game. This tutorial. If you enjoyed it, make sure to like this video and subscribe to this channel. I'll be releasing a lot of interesting videos in the upcoming weeks. And I'll be releasing a very exciting MediaPipe course full of applications. Link will be in the description below to join it. Finally, I have a challenge for you. If you enjoy this tutorial, make sure to download the notebook and then after running it, restructure the code so that it works to control some other application or some other game. And once you do that successfully, make sure to tag me on LinkedIn and share the demo. And I'll make sure to give you a shout out and share your demo with my network. So I'm very excited to see what you're going to build. And I'll see you in the next video. Bye.